And burdening patriarchies. We have three presenters. There's Ikazi Tao, Samuel Mbluli, and Joy Joseph, who will be presenting. And they will introduce themselves when they're introducing their papers. So, welcome, Sipokan.
Hi, good morning everyone. I'm Samuel Mbluli. I'm a master's student at Nelson Mandela University. That's pretty much it for now. So in this paper, I make an attempt really to look at ways in which we could disable patriarchy, right? But I'm particularly locating it within cultural practices that are found within some of our African cultures. I'm particularly going to look at the practice of Kukulaya as well as Horoula, which positions senior women as ceremonial patriarchs. So I'll explore these ideas a little bit later. Sorry if there are married women here. So I argue in this paper that patriarchy as a system is maintained importantly because these senior women take up the role of the male, right, in how they relate to junior women in their respective cultures. So junior women, I'm particularly looking at newlywed women, omakoti, right? So how the ways in which they relate to these junior women by embodying the violences of patriarchy and performing their violences on these junior women, right? So culture for many is seen as, you know, the cornerstone of, or the foundation of this group of people. In its function and its continuation, or in its sustainability, it carries an archive of knowledge of a particular group of people. It socializes one on certain constructions and understandings of the world. It is an institution that protects, that develops languages, behaviors, and attitudes, music and art, which are all relevant, right, and unique to a particular group of people. Culture, as Bahati Kumba and Patricia McFarlane postulate, is multifaceted. It is difficult and it is complex, right, and contradictory at times. And so the complexity of culture, as they further argue, carries implications with respect to a person's interests, freedoms, and rights. One of the arguments, of course, against culture has been that culture in its articulation serves the male-bodied, cisgendered person in the culture. And often African women are seen as people where culture happens to, as opposed to people that are actively working in making the culture, right? And so African societies, like other forms of collections of people, are comprised of structures and systems that guide the ways in which people who buy into that culture navigate and make meaning of the world. For me, African feminisms has sparked a conversation on the contentions between society and the individual. So it has me thinking about the relationship between I as the agent and culture as a structure that I subscribe to. Marriage, as a structure and system in culture, is viewed as the building block of most societies. It is considered a safe haven for bringing up children, and ensuring that they become balanced and productive citizens. In some cases, marriage is regarded as social capital, where married persons can contribute to conversations and decision-making within their communities, in churches, and these are things that non-married persons cannot necessarily do. And so the question I'm asking is, when African women actively enter cultures through marriage, so they buy into this institution, what becomes the relationship between the agency and their roles in maintaining this said culture? Considering that through the institution of marriage, in many cultures there is an existence of semi-autonomous women's structures and activities. These semi-autonomous structures are woman-led and operate under the broad function of particular cultures. So examples of this are Ukulaya, in the Isikosa culture, also found in the Sesotho culture, Kolaya, which is the advice ceremony of a newlywed woman on how to perform her new identity or how to perform her womanhood as per the the procedure of that particular cultural family. The other structure is horoula, right, which is a Sesotho practice of a woman mourning her husband. And so such structures are exclusive to married women, and in some cases, divorced women, widowed women, but all of these would be women that have institutional knowledge of how womanhood operates within that particular culture. And these structures are generally run, of course, by borakhadi or tabao, like great aunts, for example, mother-in-laws, and also senior makotis, who would have been women that would have been that would have entered this particular culture through marriage before this particular person that's about to be guided, right? And so, in valuing this idea of an autonomous woman's structure in African culture, in this paper, I position senior women who run these structures as the ceremonial patriarchs. But I'll come back to this idea in a moment. So I grew up as I still am a bicultural individual. I identify as both Mxhosa and a Sesotho person. And so what that has allowed me to do is access into the various complexities, linguistic nuances that both these cultures carry, right? Furthermore, for me, it has allowed me to ask the question what it means to be part of a culture, and what your role becomes when you buy into that culture, right, and when you agree to be part of that culture. So on this one occasion, my Mxhosa grandmother and I were watching a popular South African soapy, right? And this scene that caught our attention is one of the Smagoti who was living with her in-laws. Of course, this is not an odd thing, because as a newlywed, typical practice is that you'd be expected to reside with your in-laws in order for you, of course, to perform what you would have been advised to perform, but also your in-laws are also where you would then be serving, right, your duties as umagoti. But what caught my grandmother's attention was more the makoti's representation of dress, right? So my grandmother responds by saying, "You, umakoti have a new James in," right? Which loosely is, I'll try, how dare a makoti dress like this in the presence of her in-laws, right? So the makoti was wearing a short sleeve, sleeveless jumpsuit. And my grandmother's response to this dress by umakoti was suggesting that she was not demonstrating respect of her new identity, particularly in the presence of her in-laws, whom she is meant to serve. Sibonile Ellis postulates that the significance of ukulaya, or the advice ceremony, ensures the sustainability of patriarchy, because the senior woman, the ceremonial patriarchs, who should logically tell the bride to do things that are beneficial to her, from the perspective of female solidarity, instead tell her to do things that are potentially detrimental to her welfare. My grandmother, in her critiquing of this new makoti, was suggesting that the representation of dress by makoti, or lack thereof, was not in accordance with how a makoti ought to perform her new identity and womanhood. Dress, in the Isixhosa culture, is important in the sense that it symbolizes the status of the wearer, right? The makoti in this context. So a typical makoti would wear a black headscarf, a shweshwe blanket over her shoulders, she wear a long sleeve white top, or a shirt, or a long sleeve white shirt. She'll have a towel wrapped around her upper body. She'll be wearing a woolen scarf around her waist and a traditional long brown or blue seshesha skirt, right? Masina reminds us that every culture has its own definitions of what a worthy woman is. These definitions include the expectations of society concerning the roles which women are expected to play in order to qualify as worthy women in their communities. My grandmother, in articulating what I read to be a disapproval, was in fact speaking to a makoti who was not sufficiently fulfilling her role as per procedure. This taking up of a new identity is important to demonstrate the symbolic transition to welcome a young girl into womanhood. Dress, in the African cultural context, is important as it forms part of the culture's meaning making in relation to social roles within the culture and society. Dress, as Pamela Maseko reminds us, functions as a form meaning-making without the usage of language and words. Culture, I suggest here, should not be only about affirming, maintaining, and performing culture, right? But should also consider voice, communication, and the understanding of women as political and historical actors. My critique of the structure of marriage of Ukuyala is that senior women, like my grandmother, who dictate the knowledge exchange in this space, do not allow Makotis as junior women who buy into the culture, right, to negotiate how they would like to participate in maintaining and sustaining the culture. Knowledge in this space is linear. There's a very clear power dynamic which leaves the Makoti as having to either conform or to then be rejected and therefore seen as not good women enough, right? Or good women. Okay. So this is possible because the social structure and organization of marriage is based on gender and sex roles. And as such, the role of senior women in the Xhosa culture particularly carries these patriarchal attitudes. If we accept that African women have the agency to construct their realities, to what extent are senior women within African cultures able to challenge old hierarchies and expectations? Importantly so, the idea of being expected to perform good womanhood through dress occupies contesting identities of how the contemporary woman, Umakoti, would identify or would latch onto. Ola reminds us that the apartheid system functioned on the regulation of bodies with limiting movement. However, in a new South Africa, the female body could be seen as free, as mobile, as flourishing, as exploratory. And so the usage of dress as an articulation of good womanhood and respectability within the Xhosa framework is the creation of a moral compass which articulates status, which articulates status and power by senior women in the culture towards junior women. And so the model of Ukuyala in how it operates ignores the various possibilities of how Makotis can represent themselves within their new cultures and communities, because it carries this monolithic representation of womanhood. I suggest in this instance that it is women who are at the center of influencing dress within a cultural setting, and as the custodians of this particular practice, there are implications where they are implicated in the sense that they endorse a value system that does not consider the agency of a new Makoti, right? And instead, it upholds the patriarchal attitudes, of course. So senior women, like my grandmother, are not engaged in a discussion that frees women from historical disadvantage relative to men, of course, and towards gender injustice. But instead, it silences them and further teaches silence as a way of how they become acceptable in the structure of marriage. Although Makotis are aware that they buy into this culture, and by doing so, they stand to lose their self. Senior women in the Xhosa structure, I believe, are responsible for the transferring of knowledge of how the culture and the structure of marriage functions from a woman's lens. And so it is thus my critique that they do not use their agency in a way that is transformative to this curriculum that they teach the junior woman. The senior women in the Xhosa culture do not exercise the agency in ways that can be beneficial to creating intergenerational bonds and links to strengthen the women's collective mobilizations. And so senior women in African cultures take up the role of the patriarch, right, and use symbolisms of dress to oppress and hold power over junior women. Often than not, it is these women, as McFadden suggests, who reflect patriarchy and maintain their identities through culture. The choice of agency maybe so that they attain power. However, it means that there's a loss of there's a lost possibility of building strands of solidarity amongst women in this particular culture. So about 2 years ago, when my brother passed, I was quite interested in how my sister-in-law was going to go through her process of grieving and mourning, right? And I was quite interested in it because my brother and I did not have a close relationship in his later life, right? And so I thought that she would be an interesting case study, oddly, a case study, in expressing how he would have liked to be remembered in his later life, right, which she shared with him. And so it should not have been a surprise to me that the process of the funeral would have been as per the structure of Sesotho and the relevant Christian denomination that he subscribed to. I had, however, naively thought that a person's way of living their life should succeed structures that they had subscribed to, right? And so, but I particularly had this thinking because my brother was someone who could opt in and out of particular practices and structures if he deemed them unnecessary. And so I thought that his character would then play itself out in how we were going to bury him. So when my sister-in-law heard of the news of her husband's passing, her response was, "Yo, ga gona hunters nyana," which loosely is there no hunter's dry cider in the vicinity that could aid in my distress? Thank you. So this I did not hear, of course, from my grandmother. It is my mother, my Xhosa mother, who's married into the Sesotho culture, who tells me the story when I arrive about 2 days before the funeral. She says, "You, umakoti funi hunters tina sicunguncwa," right? which loosely is, "Oh my God, this makoti is thinking about drinking when we are busy trying to think about this funeral. She has no shame." So what I observed in this conversation between my mother, the senior makoti, and my sister-in-law, the junior, was a silencing of how my sister-in-law wanted to articulate her grief. I could not understand why she was viewed as disrespectful or uncultured for making such a request. After all, she was a non-drinker. And more so, they were like engaged in drinking when they were married to my brother, right? But then I also started thinking about the drinking of alcohol during deaths and funerals, right? Mm-hmm. And which is not a new practice in African cultures. So the making of mqombothi, traditionally brewed beer, and even the idea of after tears, right? Mm. When you celebrate after the procession, right? And you celebrate through engaging alcohol. Very consumerist, but sure. So prior to me hearing this story of what my sister-in-law did, and in thinking about my sister-in-law, I was imagining all the practices that I have seen women and girl children do when there's a funeral. I was distressed on her behalf. I could not imagine sitting still, sometimes alone and quiet, as a way of mourning, especially when I'm being told to do so as opposed to choosing to. Of course, common practice after the death of a person in the Sesotho culture and leading to the funeral is that, you know, the furniture is removed from the house, the widow or the mother of the children of the deceased are expected to sit on a mat or mattress, usually it's going to be in the bedroom. They would often be facing the wall. Of course, they can go to the bathroom. They cannot leave the space. They'll be covered in a cloth or a blanket. So, but basically any form of recreational that the person enjoyed before this unforeseen event would be prohibited. And so this practice constructs mourning through marriage for me as experienced by a woman as a series of duties that she has to perform and sacrifices she has to make. So the idea of questioning or being assertive is viewed as being uncultured and not a good representation of good womanhood. Mm-hmm. My argument here is that senior women use culture as a silencing tool against junior women to label inauthentic those black women who resist the structures of patriarchy, as Mozine reminds us. Patriarchy as a structure creates a hierarchy and gives women a secondary status in society. Sultana postulates that within a society or culture, patriarchy gives absolute priority to men and to some extent limits women's human rights. And patriarchy has and continues to be linked to the male body, and this then assumes that patriarchy can only be performed by the male cisgendered body. Mm-hmm. However, I want to argue that patriarchy is a role that is filled by bodies, mostly male bodies, yes, cisgendered. However, in the cases of my grandmother and my mother, female and woman bodies can take up the role in the absence of the male. So they become these ceremonial patriarchs that are entrusted with maintaining the status quo. One of the questions Thabiseng Motsepe asked us is, how do we give space to silenced voices that remain neglected, marginalized, or outright forgotten? Important to understand is that Horaula as a practice shows that a lost life is worth being grieved, right? Mm-hmm. However, there is an upholding of care, of caring about mourning practices in the community, of which there is a struggle to find meaning in the mourning practices themselves. And this struggle is too caused by the fact that the symbolism of woman and the construction of woman within structures, especially junior women, forces her to either conform to the socially sanctioned and acceptable norms. As I conclude, if we are to think of practices within cultures as rites of passages, as ways in which people ascend to higher social ranking or to their higher selves in society, then I think we ought to consider and be critical of the work that autonomous spaces like Ukuyala Horaula that are led by women and what they are doing in gatekeeping and thus creating obstacles for women to enjoy their culture. Mm-hmm. In these cases, senior women are in charge of the curriculum of the practices. However, the junior women cannot locate themselves within this curriculum. They, as we see with the Makoti, with the sleeveless jumpsuit, and my sister-in-law, who needs a cider to soothe her pain, are writing against this archive only to be pushed back to the margins. So importantly, I suggest, we need to consider the ways in which the current running of practices do not allow the junior woman to have ownership of these practices and be part of making the curriculum of Ukulaya and Horaula, amongst others, which are all relevant practices that could either influence whether women buy in or buy out of a culture.
I had to be a little bit creative about how I was going to present this, because of course, given I think what has been happening this week, I found it very challenging to complete what I was writing. I had to stop. And so, in thinking through how I would creatively present this, I will begin with sort of how I've structured the presentation, which is firstly a song from Dr. Jonas Skwamba, who I went to visit actually yesterday. yesterday afternoon. He's not well, he's ailing. And it's because I'm working on an exhibition that's kind of to honor the contributions made to jazz. But I start with this track titled Flowers of the Nation, because for me I think it kind of encapsulates the moment that we're in thinking of course, the symbolism of the flower, right? That women as flowers, but also in mourning, and how flowers are a symbol also of renewal and birth and beauty and love. So yes, I'll pay just for 2 minutes for us to, as a moment of silence. And so I did that, I think, as well because of the way in which creative work for me has informed my practice, not just as a black woman, but as an artist. "Let a thousand flowers bloom" is a common misquotation of Chairman Mao Zedong's "Let a hundred flowers bloom," which was borrowed from Zedong's, from a line of a Chinese poem. And the Chinese poem goes, "Let a hundred schools of thought contained." The slogan was used during the period of approximately 6 weeks in the summer of 1957, when the Chinese intelligentsia were invited to criticize the political system then obtaining in China, communist China. The full quotation taken from a speech in Mao's speech of 1957 in February reads, let a hundred flowers blossom and a hundred school of thought contend in the policy for promoting progress in the arts and the science and a flourishing society, socialist culture in our land," end quote. In using this anecdote, I'm attempting to think through what it actually would look like to recreate a moment of letting a thousand flowers bloom. Of creating a moment that not only advocates for black solidarity, but black solidarity with black women. Across class, economic, or cultural definitions. To participate in a moment that is, in a sense, a call to urgency and what our revolutionary deputy for Nantes, that are kind of dominating the public domain right now, right? In this question of, oh my body, make me always a man or woman who questions. I do not only suggest that although the statement prompts a sense of contestation, especially with our black male counterparts, when it comes to black women, and the points and how it points to the many betrayals that black women have suffered at the hands of black men. In his speech, Mao indeed declares his solidarity for the policy that would allow criticism of bureaucracy, provided that writers and intellectuals put forth competing ideologies, opinion, and did not engage in destructive acts. And so I refer to this historical moment as a way of reflecting upon the current moment characterized by the scourge of heightened violence perpetrated against women, particularly black women across socio-economic class and status, who for the longest time have been at the epicenter of resisting, challenging, and confronting patriarchy by their very existence, of creating space where 100 flowers can blossom. This fact, I argue, black men are indeed aware of, and have always been aware of this. However, when it comes to the critical space of intellectual discourse around blackness, it seems black women present a clear threat, so to speak, that essentially boils down to a sentiment where, to refer back to Mao's quote, the movement was spiraling out of control, and he had to squash it. "The fragrant flowers," he announced, "must be distinguished from the poisonous weeds. Criticism will no longer be tolerated." My inference to this speech is, however, more rooted in the deep-seated feeling of betrayal, felt at a moment where that encapsulates how, when it comes to black women in the political and cultural sphere, there is a significant testament that betrayal has not only been a persistent, but also a consistent reoccurrence of how we feature in any revolutionary movement. And so, just to be clear, you know, this paper is not, or these thoughts I'm going through are not about betrayal as such. I think I'm thinking more around how do we acknowledge black women who have contributed to publicly to public intellectual discourse. And creatively as well. This comes with a process, I believe, with dismantling South African art institutions, but however requires a deeper understanding of the perception that art making is an indulgent activity regarded as a sophisticated and contemplative act solely understood through the lens of the bourgeoisie. When it detaches itself from the from this notion, it is either rationalized in a socialist cultural revolutionary fashion, or curiously cloaked in both scholarship and commercial consumption, or spaces of scholarship and commercial consumption. The detachment of art from society and from the current debates in the cultural politics or the politics or the culture of politics within institutions of higher learning points to this. This detachment can thus not only solely be attributed to a long-standing history of an estrangement from the political concerns of the social well-being of a majority of black people living in South Africa in general, mostly who are poor, but should rather, as I suggest, be interrogated through a different kind of sensibility or approach. Acknowledging women's contribution, or black women's contribution in creative practice, in bringing disciplines such as painting and embroidery work, or as vast as that, right? Talk about a raw articulation of these two different types of creative practice as embodied within a tradition of what I call women's work. This women's work, I suggest, is informed by how the approach to black women as a subject matter alludes to a disclosure of transgressions of the past, the present, and the future. In these, I create a tension between becoming and being, concealing and revealing, retreating and showing up, all of which are embodied in the audacious negotiations black women have to make in navigating their existence in society. And so I think about what is creative practice as an act of being or becoming and retreating. This oscillation appears to have since evolved, I think, for me, in a strategic sense, as an artistic language that starts to articulate what I refer to this woman's work, and that it is specific to the condition of being a black woman in South Africa today. This is not to make black women or the female condition, or the black female condition, seem exceptional to other women of color, or even appear as timid, but rather as an important symbol of how societal structures have marginalized, dehumanized, and disenfranchised certain women. By a kind of women work, I'm also suggesting that black women's repertoire is part of a lexicon of creative work that is done as a vehicle towards a cathartic activity, but also one that is specific to the condition of being a black woman. It is also important to note that women's work, as I put it, does not really make a gender distinction between work that is made by men or made by women. Rather, it's referring to how there's a particular kind of intellectual, meditative state of being that requires making certain kind of work through a creative process that women have pioneered. So what is creative critical intellectual thought, and who can participate in it? Black women have always been, or the black woman or the black woman's body has always been transposed as a site of political welfare and social injustice, be it through its violation and abuse in structures of power in the past or the present, or any societal or political sphere. However, it is also a bold symbol of true liberation and freedom, achieved against adversity as the worst kind of oppression that comes in the form of a set of patriarchal structures that have ensured that black women remain at the bottom of social and hierarchical chain. What this means is that every member of society who sees themselves above a black woman essentially feels entitled to look down, comment upon, abuse, violate, speak at, speak on behalf of, accept, and reject whenever they choose or it suits them. I therefore end off referring back to Mao's quote of letting a thousand flowers bloom, and then I'll finish off with an open letter from James Baldwin to Angela Davis. And I employ I go back to Mao's quote to kind of paint a picture of the kinds of false allegiance that has come not only in light of making this contemporary moment where black women stand both intellectually and critically as contributors to public and creative intellectual life, but are not acknowledged as such. especially in relation to the black counterparts, the black male counterparts, sorry. Acknowledging this fact is often the work of black feminists who have to do this work, right? And perform it to a point where you're kind of working against a fraught system of power that continues to maintain a particular kind of understanding and articulation of who black women are and how they should be participating in public intellectual consciousness. And so to end off, I'll read the last paragraph of this open letter from James Baldwin to Angela Davis. So be it. We cannot awaken the sleeper, and God knows we have tried. We must do what we can do, and fortify and save each other. We are not drowning in an apathetic self-contempt. We do feel ourselves sufficiently worthwhile to contend even the inexorable forces in order to change our fate and the fate of our children and the condition of the world. We know that man is not a thing and is not to be placed at the mercy of things. We know that air and water belong to all mankind and not merely to industrialists. We know that the baby does not come into the world merely to be the instrument of someone else's profit. We know that democracy does not mean the coercion of all into a deadly and finally wicked mediocrity, but the liberty for all to aspire to the best that is him, that is in him, and that has ever been. We know that we, the blacks, and not only we, the blacks, have been and are the victims of a system whose only fuel is greed, whose only God is profit. We know that the fruits of the system have been ignorance, despair, and death. We know that the system is doomed because the world can no longer afford it, if indeed it ever could have. And we know that for the perpetuation of this system, we have all been mercilessly brutalized and have been told nothing but lies. Lies about ourselves, our kinsmen, and our past, and about love, life, and death, so that both soul and body have been bound in hell. The enormous revolution in black consciousness, which has occurred in your generation, my dear sister, means the beginning of the end of America. Some of us, white and black, know how great a price has already been paid to bring into existence a new consciousness, a new people, an unprecedented nation. If we know and do nothing, we are worse than the murderers hired in our name. If we know, then we must fight for our life as though we were our own. It were our own, which it is, and render impassable with our bodies the corridor to the gas chamber. For if they take you in the morning, they will be coming for us at night. Therefore, peace. James Baldwin, your brother.
Molweni.
Hello.
Guten Morgen. Bonjour. Bon dia. Nimen how? What language is that? I can't remember. Okay, good morning, everybody. You know, we have to speak the language of the indigenes. So I learned Molweni and I learned De La La Nomieni Wam, Portland Square number 4. I was actually going to say I live with my spouse, and I ended up saying in the La La instead of in the Hagla. I was calling this sponsor because I want to speak the language. So you know what that means, okay? I don't want us to be too academic, so I need that to make you laugh. You know, I'm moving away from hegemonic masculinity, Magondi. We're going to talk about marginalized masculinity in Ramone Sanusi's Enek Aviole Iblon Adalats. Enek Aviole Iblon Adalats, it's a book written in 2016 by Ramone Sanusi, Francophone Studies. I would explain that I actually left it the way it is. Can you have an abstract? I left it the way it is because I don't want to make a wrong translation. Now we're going to talk about problems about racial discrimination. Enek, a nigger raped a blonde woman in Dallas. Now if you look at the word neg means nigger, not noir. Noir is black.
Yes.
You understand? So instead of saying Enoa Aviole Implon Adalat, to tell you from the inset of the book, you already know, the author says Eneg Aviole Implon Adalat, a nigger raped a blonde woman in Dallas. So you have an idea of what I'm going to talk about. Now we have different forms of masculinity. According to Cornell, marginalized forms of masculinity are seen as hyper-masculinity, and this includes drug abuse, alcoholism, violence, dictatorship, wars, prostitution, theft. Sanusi affirms that, wow, l'homme est né bon, mais la société l'a changé. Man is born a responsible person, but the society influenced him negatively. Mm-hmm. Now, in this book, the book Eneg, I did not bring it because when I was returning from a conference in the States, all my research materials were stolen. My laptop, the books for presentation. So I told myself, no more book for any presentation. I don't want to go through such a very sad experience again. Now, what happened is that in the book, you have a young boy who was living with his uncle. And the uncle could not tolerate him. He kicked him out of the house. And then Adenako was thrown out of his uncle's house, and he became a bandit and a terrorist in his society. So he was rejected by his own people, like somebody said yesterday. And then in a bid to survive, he got into what he got involved in. Now let me say again that I like what Kanita Mohammed says. She said, if violence is about subjugating others, we don't want. And I want to accept, we don't want such violence. And then my sister said, if we know what we know, we must fight for it. We're tired of keeping silent. We don't want to die before our time. If you die, they'll forget about you and go to the bank and take all your money. And say, all she did was reading. Now she's gone, let's have her money. So I've chosen to leave. It's either you accept me, that society accepts me the way I am, or it's fine.
Yeah.
Now, and he says, pronto sake va a Lagos to debrie, come to camarade. Please take your bag and leave and go to Lagos and act like what? Your mate. What does he expect from a boy of about 6 years old? The rejection of Adenako by his uncle Baba Ali as a result of poverty led to Adenako's flight to Lagos, where he met a gangster and introduced him into the business. Now, when I use business here, I'm in literature, I don't speak directly. I'm sure you know the business of rape, the business of racial discrimination, the business of prostitution. You know what I mean? That's what I mean by the business. And then he says, my uncle becomes violent when he has no dime in his pocket. So there's subjugation, there's marginalization, there's violence everywhere, which pushes people to do what they're not supposed to do, like what you see here. Now you see, this is in the book, this is different forms of marginalized masculinity. Now you can see how somebody is smartly taking something from somebody's bag, and it cuts across continents, it cuts across Africa, everywhere. It's not only everything black is black, I don't accept, it's everywhere. Now you see in the bus, well, this was what they were doing in the book. And then you see that man there, in French, we call it Chinovi. He's about stealing. And then you see the other one that we all know. I'm not going to talk about it. Now, when he got to Lagos, he was introduced into what we call École de Cambriolage, the school of robbery. And then Adenako met with Agbako, introduced him into the school of robbery. Why do we call it a school of robbery? You know, he was kicked out. So he got into that society and he was roaming. Somebody need to accept him. He has been rejected. So, and he had to go through a process to make meaning in the society, but it was a negative process. There was rejection first from his background before he started whatever he was doing. So he said, Abako m'a fait découvrir les boîtes de nous divers, a émis d'initiation dans une école de cambriolage. Là, on nous a appris à faire le pickpocket, on nous a appris à fumer le champ. Là, on nous a appris à violer les femmes. When you hear violer, it means what? Rape a woman. On nous a appris à manier la Kalashnikov. That is what? Manipulating the gun. So you have, Abaka made me discover several clubs. I was made to go through an initiation process in the school of robbery. There we were taught pickpocketing, how to mock spoke Indian hen, how to rape a woman, how to maneuver the Kalashnikov gun. We came out of that school well-trained and prepared to steal and also to kill if necessary. Now you have two sets that keep volaying, nous appartenait à cet argent. All the items that were stolen. Now, to make something out of life, he got involved in what I call marginalized forms of masculinity. You have the domination of the woman, the man, and the environment. But this is not done from the just from the physical perspective. There's a training process, and it comes with a lot of people. Now, there's also the spiritual process of this kind of training, which is detrimental to the society, especially to the woman. Now, he says, when the uncle said, go to Lagos and come back, what he did was, these were all the things that he did. I used this figure to describe who Ajanaku became in the society, Father Christmas. What does he do? But these were actually stolen stuff. Now, I don't want to paint a negative image here because my name is Joy. I don't want people to be here. Like, why is she coming with so much negativity? No, I'm Joy. So you have to laugh. And I'm tired of being formal, okay? You have to try and laugh here. So when he came back from those activities that I highlighted, this was what he became to the society. And he said, Tout le monde était content de moi, si riche, si robust. Now he had stolen, and he had come back to his society. He was now what? Accepted. Remember, it was this same society that actually threw him out. Now, his uncle who said, va à Lagos, va te débrouiller, fais comme tes amis, go and behave like your mates, was now proud of him. He said, Ali Baba était fier de son enfant, son demandé l'origine de sa richesse. Ali Baba was proud of his nephew. He didn't bother about asking, you know, he didn't bother about the source of his wealth. Now, I'm describing different forms of marginalized masculinity. Now, Ali Baba was not acting, Ajanaku was not acting alone. He had a gang. To survive, they got into falsification of documents. These are different forms of what? Marginalized masculinity in the society in a bid to what? To survive. In a bid to oppress the woman, in a bid to oppress the man, in a bid to oppress, you know, in society, people do also. So he goes during a tourist session, he stole documents. And then what happens? And that he had to take it to somebody. This another form of marginalized form of masculinity is where you falsify documents that are not real just because you want to make ends meet. And that's what Kanita said. If your violence is about subjugating others, we don't want that kind of what? Violence. We are tired. So his own machine, Emekami had a machine that in disguise was a machine used to do what? Suppress and marginalize people. Because people will take these documents and it will become it. So it says, Ajanaku, le coup est bien joué. La photo du propriétaire de son passeport de raison. Tu gardes son nom. Désormais, son nom sera comment? C'est seulement la photo que je vais changer. From now on, he says, Ajanaku, everything is in order. The picture of the owner of this passport resembles you. You are going to keep his name and just change his image. Now, this is oppression. This is marginalization. This is subordination. All because, you know, you want to be better than some other people. Now, Ajanaku, in a collaboration with Emekami, changes a stolen passport to suit the purpose of his dubious activities. Another form of what? Violence. Now, Ajanaku did not work alone. He had a gang. And what they're saying as women is, these people work together, oppressing us as women. So if you cannot be, you say, if you cannot beat them, you join them, which is not supposed to be. So Ajanaku worked with Baba Eshu, who was very powerful. Now, this is the spirituality. Yeah, we are Africans now. It's time to talk about spiritual matters. You can't deny the fact that there's spirituality in what? In Africa. These things don't just happen. It's another form of violence. Do your thing, your own thing. Don't try to oppress, you know, people with whatever the person is doing. So here we have somebody who says, Eshu avait plein de pouvoir mystérieux. Il pouvait se disparaître comme dans le vent. I'll say that in English. Eshu was a very powerful man. He could disappear into thin air. He could transform himself into a bear, into a cat, and via different kinds of what? Incantations. This is where the spirituality in African science, I don't know if I should use that word. Black science, I don't know if I should use that word. Black power, I don't know if I should use that word. But choose the word that is convenient for you. You see oppression coming up this way. So it says, in this text, we see that marginalized forms of masculinity are considered with black power, black magic, which makes it difficult for perpetrators to be caught. Now, I'm not against black power, whatever you do. My point is, there's oppression, there's marginalization, there's subordination because somebody has something that is better than you. Do it for yourself. But when you have to do it against somebody, that's where there is a problem. Now, he was not just walking. He didn't have a local network. He had contacts all over the world. So I'm here to say that this problem of marginalized forms of masculinity cuts across continents, black, white, purple, indigo, violet, orange, gray, whatever. You have these problems. You see, Eshu have contacted Paris, celui le patron de Diap du monde entier. Eshu had correspondence in different parts of the world. So what happens in South Africa that we attend as whatever we are, it's happening in Europe, it's happening in New York, it's happening in France, but we the black, the painters. The circle goes round not only in Africa, but in Europe, Asia, all over the world. Now search for power. This is where we talk about marginalized forms of masculinity. Now for this man to succeed, this is what he is doing. You know, how many of you watch Nollywood? Nollywood. Yes. Igwe and all that. This is Igwe here. And if you have watched Nollywood, if you had watched Wives on Strike yesterday, this is part of it. So he goes to the hunters, they make him strong. So that when he perpetrates violence on me and you, you cannot react because he's carrying something more powerful. The circle goes round again. Now, in New York, okay, he goes from that Paris, now he's in New York. This is what is happening in New York. On my fair and welcome press on Tio de la Droga, Fumé de la, do they call Avexi de la Gorge, they found Ashwazi. Now, you have women. He said, they found Ashwazi means there is women, there are women to do what? To choose. And what that invariable means is, do whatever you like to the woman, because she's what? An object. Mm-hmm. Now, here, you see that marginalized forms of masculinity moves away now from the society to people who are supposed to protect us and not what? Perpetrators. Now you see, Osi, nothing for the boys today. I beg, because I no get change. He says, bring them, we go change them. Now this is bribing the policeman. Police, don't you have anything for me? And the policeman says, oh no, bring it, we've got change, we'll sort it out. So the people who are supposed to be protecting us in some way are also perpetrators of marginalized form of masculinity. So it keeps going round and round. He says, j'avais des amis action de l'immigration, j'avais des amis douaniers, j'avais des amis action de l'aéroport. Everywhere he had friends at the immigration, friends who worked at the border, friends. So you have this thing cutting across every continent, everywhere, which becomes a problem in the society. Now Ajanaku raped a blonde. Now he actually did not rape the girl. He got so much money, he said, and then he had this little lady who was living with him. She screamed at night, and it was not actually a rape. She wanted money. But somehow he was caught, and because he had money and he had influence and he had the spiritual signs, he escaped. So you see, perpetrators of marginalized masculinity that are detrimental to the success, to the emancipation of a black woman, there's always escape. So we have no voice. And it goes on. This implies that people who perpetrate marginalized forms of masculinity are never caught as a result of influence and magical stroke, supernatural powers. Now finally, when he saw that he had gone through all these processes and he had escaped, remember that he had, you know that thing we put black, you know, I don't want to call it. He got so much money, and this was what he did at Dallas. He built a house in Dallas, and his name changed from Ajanaku to Chief Jean-Claude Pacino. He was given this name because he was saying, dollar speaks. I have money, and I can do whatever I want to do with money. Ajanaku escaped. Ill-gotten word made him so rich that he was Chief Claude Pacino, having built different mansions. His money spoke for him. Finally, marginalized forms of masculinity remains detrimental to man and the society. This form of masculinity should be discouraged in order to have a fair and just society. Now, I don't know who's black, I don't know who's white, I don't know who's indigo. I've succeeded in working with everybody that you see here, and I believe that we should work as a team to make our society a better place. Now, I'm going to play this slide. I'm done now. I'm done.
Joy Ifeanyi Yin Shu, Joseph, and Fred Stallings. On one hand, the Stallings demonstrated through literary writing how hegemonic and marginalized forms of masculinity are the dominant forms of masculinity in West Africa, having negative effects not only on women, but also on West African society in general. On the other hand, the study has integrated the analysis of social change with respect to the theory of Stiwanism, that is, social transformation, including women in Africa. Congratulations.
Yes.
PhDs was there. Mm-hmm. The man who said I was not going to do the PhD was there. Mm-hmm. The group of men who fought, mm-hmm. they were there.
Mm-hmm.
It was victory mm-hmm. that I came out.
Yeah.
Now, that's why I had to do this. I didn't know when I had to do this. I told them I wanted to do an indigenous theory of Stevenism. And they said, Cecilia, you're not going to graduate. And I said, you leave my way. Now, the other part of the story is that they tried, when I was pregnant and I lost the baby died. I'll sit down and I'll slump, they'll rush me to the hospital. And then one day somebody said to me, all you do is research, a man. All you do is research, everybody says you are bright or a sterile woman. And I said, what is the relationship between sterility and what? Academics. So that was what, so I challenged him and it became a university issue. I was ready to take him to court because we refused to be silent. We're tired.
Yes.
You don't have a right to call us names that we are not names.
Yes.
You know, but somehow, somebody called and said, Joy, get the PhD there, you can deal with these people. Yes. But then he told somebody that everything we did to stop her did not work. Mm-hmm. What that meant was that there was a spiritual part of marginalized forms of masculinity that was used against her as a woman that did not work.
Yes.
So he said it is not as if he did that tried to pour, you know, something on me to stop and all that. This and so that was why I decided to come out boldly to say, yes, don't be weak as a woman.
Yeah.
Don't try to behave like things are not happening. You are black. Check your skin. Mm-hmm. It's black. Your hair is not silky. That shows once you are carried by a black womb, you are born into a life of struggle.
Yep.
So you over. Thank you very much.
Any of the speakers or all of them? Questions, comments? Who else? Okay, so you can start and then you. So you start, yeah.
Thanks for the presentation, you were awesome. Thank you so much. The first speaker was talking about the hunters. The hunter's drug and how drinking is part of drinking does happen at funerals. I was actually thinking about how we growing up we always knew that the widow sits on the mattress and is sedated by her friend on the mattress, because every time a cup of water is being passed, it is actually alcohol. That's the tea, the water. Yeah, that it is actually a form of sedation. So I guess your sister-in-law just probably didn't understand that it's supposed to be secret. Like they know she wants the hunter's dry.
Yeah.
Like why must she say it?
Yeah.
But yeah, I love how you're actually seeing that as a moving away or a pushing back against or a fighting of patriarchy that should actually be allowed. Because even yes, she's been sedated, yes, she is being given her hunter's drug, but the very fact that it's been done in secret is an oppression all on its own. So thank you.
Thank you. All right, there was the lady at the end at the corner. Go around, was it? She was there, yeah, and then coaches come.
I really enjoyed the talk. It really got me thinking. Especially, super guys, your paper also. I mean, one thing that really struck me is like, how do we do research on culture? But particularly in terms of the challenge of translation, how do we interpret what we see as being reflective of what we're looking for, the theoretical comments we're looking for? I mean, specifically, what I wanted to like. So I'm reading your paper. So I'm listening to your presentation, and as you're giving these words, these are the issues I'm trying to go through. Especially in terms of how is it that your research in terms of you when an act of, for example, your sister being reprimanded. How does one see that as
an issue of, what's it called, being as an issue of trying to silence her versus this is just one moment in a bigger picture that you're not seeing. Is it necessarily a silence? Because I was wondering that ukulaya, ne? Ukulaya is not just that moment when she enters the space. Ukulaya is the whole experience of being such. So now, yes, she's entering, yes, she enters that space with the wrong dress, but at the same time, she's still there. So, is that necessarily, can we say that her wearing the wrong thing is a rejection because she's also there? But the same can also be said for the mothers. They did not beat her and tell her to go away, but they just voiced their concern at that moment. I'm not saying that oppression is happening or is not happening. I'm just trying to, there's such a complexity in terms of when something we see, how do we make sense of it? For me, it's instead of saying that this act is oppressive or this is an act of agency, rather showing how is it that the person that we are viewing is able to maneuver their lives. And I come to this conclusion in particular to my experience of my culture, because I grew up in Joburg. I grew up here, and born, raised in Hillbro, moved to the suburbs, but I always had the strong connection. Every weekend we go to Sharpeville, my family are in Sharpeville. And I always, for me, my culture was always something I was outside looking in. When I was young, I hated it. I didn't like going to funerals and having to wear a dress, or we came back from funeral, there was a thing, and we had to, like, they took the blood of the guts and they made us wipe our face. I did it like begrudgingly, or I was with Lutzi, who everyone knew, she's not going to serve tea, right? And everyone knew me as that. But then I got older, and I started to understand its role, its relevance, all of these things. And if anything, I started to almost have a sense of sensitivity about my role and how we perform it. And I'm not saying I say no, but when I do go, I'm not saying I fully want to do it, but I do it as a sense of respect. And I'm saying that, remember, even your grandmothers at one day were also, those same women who were shouting at you, like they shout at you also from that position of when they were young. They were also like, But it's like, and I also like when, and also another thing, like, so now when I see younger kids, when they don't wish, I shout at them, and I'm like, oh yeah, zah, where now, you know? But I do it as a, like, I want you to be in this space, but I also do it recognizing that she's gone through an age I've gone through.
Yeah.
And so with that in mind, like, can we say culture is this? All I can say is that within the system of patriarchy, we have to respond in certain ways. And it's because of that, and this is why we respond in certain ways to certain rules and norms. We both act, we all both resist, but we are also oppressed. Isn't it the same for culture? Because even as culture changes, it moves it, but how do we say that this act of the culture is oppressive? This one is liberatory. That's just my point.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much for your question and your comment. Sipokazi will probably answer to you afterwards. But thank you. That was a good reflection. So we'll have just the last two. The last two.
Sorry.
And please make it short because of time.
Yeah, very short. Thank you very much for the papers. But I think I just have this question that arises from the presentation on betrayal of the black woman by the black man. And I think the presenter also raised it on the head that she graduated, but also she had gone through a lot of pressure from men. I also have been experiencing a lot of this betrayal by the black men. In campaigns at the time I've been doing like a non-racism university campaign that I'm having right now. And that investing with whatever was happening was affecting everybody, and including those men. And they at first they said they would support, and then when the campaign had started, they withdrew, and then I was left alone. So And then they started working with the institution against me. So it really crushed me. So I was really happy when I saw that, okay, this is not only me, it's a big thing. But then I think also the universe works in very different ways. Because when they did that, but the university now, the three rectors resigned and all that. So in other words, the campaign has been successful, but now they are now playing victim that they should be included in negotiations that we are now doing, because they are also affected. But they left me alone in a very difficult moment, and I went through a crisis when I realized that I was now alone. This journey may not going to be, they supported me at first. They said they would not participate, but they would not speak against or campaign against me. But eventually they started doing exactly that, which was very shocking for me, that this can happen. But then my question is, what can we do as black women when we encounter these men who are our brothers, our fathers, and what, but who let you down in a very moment that you need support, especially from the black people, especially the black men? We know they are violent against, but at some point you feel that the betrayal is more painful than what is happening with this other white patriarchy. Especially when they start working together against the black woman. And in my case, it was, oh, this used to be all institutions, and these men now working against one black woman.
Okay.
Thank you. So the last second one.
Okay, thank you so much for those very insightful presentations. I have a number of questions addressed to the first speaker. So the first one is, how do we confidently theorize around culture without fixing it in time, but reading it for its past and present? So I'm asking specifically about this idea of respectability politics, and how, for me, that's a big part of the colonial imaginary, right? So when you're speaking of Umakoti having to dress in a particular way, I don't necessarily think that's something that's reflective of a particular African culture, but it's very rooted in colonial ideas of how women should conduct themselves within particular settings. So I do think that there's an opportunity for that to be, I think, teased out. And then the second one is, can we definitively speak of cultures as opposed to cultural practices and traditions? Right. So if we understand the culture as something that's fluid, and particularly as South Africans with a very real history, maybe even present, of tribalism and those types of things, what do we mean when we say buy in to a particular culture, right? And how are we contesting these tribal identities or markers, if I can call them, as in light of something called popular culture, and how women express themselves, or how they negotiate that particular cultural terrain. And then, also, how do we navigate patriarchal conditions? So I think the idea of agency is always a complicated one, right? We often call women patriarchal princesses, or we say that they are the ones pushing a patriarchal agenda when they do these, or when they partake in these cultural practices. But I really do think that we do them a great disservice, because we underestimate the extent of patriarchal oppression. Is it really women buying into patriarchy, or navigating that space in the best manner in which they can, right? So I think there's room for us to think around this idea of solidarity, of women's solidarity, of feminist solidarity. If I'm saying to you, is that necessarily solidarity? And if I'm saying don't do you, am I disallowing you from practicing your agency? I think these networks are more complicated than we assume. I think there are ways in which women protect themselves, especially in very oppressive systems, such as marriage, where they say, don't do this, because they know that it has very real ramifications, right?
Sorry, we're not going to say we didn't tell me the last one.
The last one, okay.
Yeah.
just to give her a chance.
No, it's okay. Just ask your question. No, ask your question.
Ask your question.
Okay. Okay, I'll make it super quick. My question is for Samit. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to find out, I loved your presentation and I agree with a lot of things that you're saying. It also made me think about something that Bell Hooks speaks about in Art on a Mind, about sort of women creatives finding the time and the space, right, to create freely and to create undisturbed, right, because this... this work, these sort of rare moments of stillness sort of play a vital role in enhancing the nature of the work that we produce, right? And she also talks about how it's important to sort of commit to creating in spite of oppositional forces. But I wanted to ask you about like what maybe some other constructive methods of creating space, holding space, not only for each other, I guess this conference does that in one way, but how do we do that daily for ourselves and for each other?
So I'll give each of the speakers just 1 minute to give a final, just a closing comment. Just 1 minute. Not necessarily to answer the questions, but to just give a response.
Yeah, okay. So just a general response to all the comments. I do agree that it's much more complex, right? And there is another side of the coin where one is potentially unknown as to why there is a relevance and significance to certain practices, right? And that's because a lot of people have been simply accepting it as a norm and therefore practicing it instead of understanding what it is. So when I think about the idea of like mourning, right, in as much as I'm very critical of it, there is a significance in how, or understanding that when you are transitioning from being married to not being married, and so a moment of stillness so that you can get into that transition, some of the significance of that has been located within that you need to then be in a moment to understand the transition and you're about to take up a new identity.
Just 1 minute, just to respond to that.
Yeah.
Okay, to my sister, be strong from within. If you're not strong, don't bother. You'll slice your head out. I'll tell you the truth. So you have to be strong from within. And when I mean strong, African women, you know you can't start something, if you know you can't fight it, then don't start it. So you have to be strong from within. Then get yourself psychologically ready for betrayal. You have to know that you are going to be betrayed, especially from our black men. So when it comes, you are not going to be shattered, because you're already psychologically ready for what? For the betrayal. Then build your own network. Your people who believe in you. Anyone who is not ready to walk, assume the person is not existent.
Yes,
let the person face evaporate out of the planet. You don't walk with people who don't believe in you, because they'll continually bring you down. Like what the artist said yesterday, it's true. Don't walk with people who do not believe in you. You have people who believe in you. That's the people that matter.
Yeah.
Others don't matter. Let them evaporate and fade out of the continent.
Thank you.
Another one is be resilient. Don't give up. Don't dance to your tune at the end of the day. If they know that they're beating you and you come back to fight, like, she's going to come back and beat us again. So when you see that you have that strength, you move on. Then set high standards for yourself. You know what I mean by high standards? For those of us who are female scholars, if the men are reading 4, we are reading 8, 10. You know what I mean? You are extra good. I didn't get money for funding. I said I'm coming to Athens, whether funding or not.
Yes.
You can sleep anywhere. We don't care. We're not going to die.
Yes.
And if we die, we'll come back to life. You better. Thank you.
Response. So I'll say, how do we create, space undisturbed, right, spaces for ourselves? A very nice way of putting it, which is called self-care, but actually it's about being selfish,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
And plain, outright just being selfish with your time.
Mm-hmm.
And that, your time is precious, right? The other thing is creating, where do we create spaces for ourselves and others, reading and writing groups,
and taking writing retreats. For me, that has been, I think, a very liberating space, other than this kind of space. But you have to create a concerted effort to do that, to do those things.
So let's give them a big round of applause.